Go. Nine Lives, y'all, the new CD, the new
I'll
music.
Give him a hand, he's been working out. Yeah,
thank you, Paul.
Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, Paul Sanchez.
Wow, alrighty. So before I begin to do songs off of Nine Lives, after the flood, this group of crazy music fans who had no idea how to be in the music business, thank goodness, or else they'd have been different people, they banded together to start raising money for the New Orleans Musicians Clinic at an event they call the Threadhead Pottery. And in the last 4 years, they've raised almost $500,000 that they've donated to the New Orleans Musicians Clinic. Give them a hand for that. And then they had an idea at one of the potteries that John Boutte and I performed an acoustic set at, that they should start a record company. And in the last 4 years, they've raised over $400,000 and released 40 CDs by New Orleans artists who had been affected by the flood and couldn't have done it without their help. Give a hand to the Threadheads that are in the house today. Second line, feel so fine, having a threadhead state of mind. We're pottery going, good times flowing. Come on, be a threadhead. Shots and Barry's brownies, hat wearing, bread donating. Come on, be a threadhead. For 2 years, my songwriting partner, Coleman Decay, and I wrote the songs. And then when we got the Pepsi grant, which was $50,000 in September, but that was a month of organizing votes, Scott Shalit and the Threadheads, getting the votes. And then from September to October, actually November, Matt Perrine wrote furiously to get the 24 arrangements ready for the singers and musicians. And then it was November through January of recording, mixing and mastering, and it was an absolute thrill, something I'll never forget. I got to work with the most famous musicians in New Orleans. I got to work with street musicians, and it was equally thrilling and touching on each occasion. So Nine Lives is something that's going to be a part of my life, and I know the 109 people's lives that helped make it for a very long time. I hope you'll make it a part of yours at some point. This song here is a song that, on the record, it's sung by Tanya Boutte, and there's a little girl who, if you saw the La Petite show, she's in the play. She's 10-year-old Tion Johnson plays her on the record. And it was really interesting to write for her because everybody in Dan Baum's book, Nine Lives, loves New Orleans very much. And the book takes place between 1965 and 2005, and that's pretty much my consciousness on this planet. So I was well acquainted with those years. In fact, a gentleman wrote to me after hearing it. He said he'd gone to Tulane in the 60s, and hearing the record brought back a lot of memories. And he summed up in that sentence what I've been trying to articulate in interviews for months now, why I enjoyed this so much and why it became so important, why I got so emotional about it, is because doing this brought back a lot of memories, memories that got wiped away in the flood. Street signs and familiar houses and people that moved away. I got to bring them all back through Dan's book and through my favorite medium, which is song. So this one here is Belinda, and she just wanted to get out. She dreamed of getting out of the Ninth Ward and escaping the crawfish boils and the second lines and finding the perfect life and the perfect family like she watched on TV with the Waltons. And she never did quite find it. She made a bad choice senior prom and wound up marrying a man she didn't love. And when she left him, she met a man she never should have spoke to and married him. And when she worked up the courage to leave his beatings behind, she was at a backyard party with a girlfriend swearing off love forever. And she doesn't know she's about to meet the man she's going to be married to for the rest of her life. Linus turned out to be a good man. We bought a house on Delary Street. He was everything everybody ever told him that he ought to be. We weren't happy but never let on. One day me and the girls, we were gone. You might want to ask, when you look at my past, was I walking on glass? Was I walking on glass? With Snooker, I didn't know what I was thinking. How'd I ever get mixed up with him? Hoping people at the office couldn't see the bruises under my dark skin. He never did a thing but drink up my pay, beat me down and sleep it off all day. You might want to ask, when you look at my past, was I walking on glass? Was I walking on glass? On my own is my new anthem. No more husbands, not again. No more being handed cell phone numbers from very married men. One day I walked into a party, saw him bouncing on the balls of his feet. With a crooked little grin, he asked me, do I want a bite to eat? Sweet but not worth a second glance. Robert Rollins Jr. doesn't stand a chance. You might want to ask, when you look at my past, was I walking on glass? Love doesn't last, you shatter it fast when you're walking on glass. When you're walking on glass. When you're walking on glass. Some wonderful talents. We had Mr. Harry Shearer, who's a big advocate of New Orleans, even though he's not from here, he spends a lot of time here. And he sang some parts, and I play the part of Dr. Frank Mignard, our coroner. And as it turns out, we had some things in common, and I kept trying to get somebody else to sing it, but I guess it was meant for me to sing it. And Frank was from the Irish Channel, and I was from the Irish Channel, and Frank's mom was kind of coarse-spoken and maybe not the most educated person in Frank's life, and I could relate to that. And he did what he could to change his station in life, and I could relate to that. And he cheated on his first wife, and I could relate to that. So anyway, this is Frank's first song in the musical. It's a scene where he hadn't become corner yet. He's actually still a 37-year-old, the most successful gynecologist in town. an amateur trumpet player. He likes to call himself Dr. Jazz. Even had posters printed up that says so at one point in his career. And on this particular night, he's ruminating on his career on his patio as he has a few cocktails and gets drunker and drunker until in the musical he would actually pass out. Mama bought me a secondhand horn. We had no money for lessons, of course. She taught me hymns of grief. I practiced hard as if trying to change my life by force. In the hot summer days of my youth, I begged to go swim in the Audubon pool. She'd say poor whites like us don't mix well with those uptown swells and those Jews. I'll blow my own horn through my trials and tribulations. I'll blow my own horn when I succeeded and I failed. Through my greatest glories and worst humiliations. I'll blow my own horn till I'm cold, stiff, dead and pale. I find that success is a breeze. When you're wonderful as me, I got my PhD in gynecology. I got girls as far as the eye can see. On Bourbon Street, I'm Dr. Jazz. They dig the way I toss my cash. I live in a palace my wife picked out, but I really go there just to crash. I blow my own horn through my trials and tribulations. I blow my own horn when I've succeeded and I failed. Through my greatest glories and worst humiliations. I blow my own horn till I'm cold, stiff, dead and pale. From time to time a darkness gets the best of me. I find myself berating my sweet Emily. Once just because she changed her hair, I screamed at her from up the stairs. Our dinner guests were horrified and so were we. On my patio tonight, soaking in the moonlight, I slug my drink, stare at the stars, but something in me don't feel right. Oh God, my vision is going black. My breath is going slack. My yacht is sinking in a sea of useless, pointless crap. I blow my own horn, though I've had a few libations. I blow my own horn, it's always worked before. This is not the end, no, my train ain't left the station. I blow my own horn till they drag me out the door. I blow my own horn till I'm face down on the floor. Particular musical is a very dark one. You have transsexuals, you have death, you have two floodings of a major city. I thought if anybody was going to direct a musical, this would be Steven Soderbergh. He's perfect. He's got the darkness. I want to say that writing that song was interesting for me because Frank, he, like I said, grew up in the Channel, and there's a line there that says, poor whites like us don't mix well with those uptown swells and those Jews, and that's right out of the book. That was something Frank said that his mom had said. And it's something my mom easily could have said, and then so I got to write that without offending my brothers or sisters or anybody that might hear it and say, why'd you write that line? I can say, talk to Dan. But I was telling a friend of mine that New Orleans people, we don't leave our neighborhood very often, you know? Like, I hadn't really left New Orleans until I was 26 years old. I went to go live in New York City. And I was in a bar drinking, and I met this girl, and she said that she was Jewish. And I said, oh, wow, that's pretty cool. I'm from New Orleans. And before I could say anything, she went, oh, you're from the South. You must hate Jewish people. And it never occurred to me to hate Jewish people. So I said, well, I don't know. You know, I never knew there was any difference. I always, seriously, it's such a Catholic town, and I was born 1959, and New Orleans was very Catholic in the 60s, to the point where, growing up, I seriously thought that Presbyterian, Episcopalian, Jewish, I thought that was like Catholics in different neighborhoods in the city. You know, it must be a different parish, they call it something else, man, you know. And so I asked her, I said, like, what's the difference? She says, well, I'll, you know, ask me a few things and I'll tell you. And I said, well, you know, you have saints? And she goes, no, we don't have saints. I was dumbstruck. I said, well, who do you pray to when you lose something? You know? And she said, well, we go straight to God. And I was like, wow, direct line to God when you lose something. That's pretty cool. You don't have to go through a secretary or nothing. And so I said, you know, well, Jesus? And she goes, oh, no, it's definitely out. He was just another guy. And I said, well, that's what he tried to say, you know. And then I said, well, if you don't have saints, who do you see? Who do you see when you want to get in the pearly gates? And she said, oh, we don't have an afterlife. I said, you don't have a heaven? And she said, no, 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 you lead a good life. And I said, well, where's the vig? You know, like, what's God's juice? You know, he's got nothing? You just lead a good life and sayonara, here, just pat you on the ass and throw you out the door? You know, Catholics were different, man. We had hellfire to keep us straight. I don't even believe anymore, but I still fear that hellfire now and again. Just to make sure I'm well acquainted, I'd like to light up an occasional weed just to make sure it's, you know, fire's friendly. So this here song, I got to make fun of my own upbringing, but I also lived about seven blocks from the 2525 St. Charles, which in the book Dan refers to as the Rex Mansion. And the character of Billy Grace, he married into the family that lived there. And it was his life's desire to one day be the king of Mardi Gras, and he became the king of Rex. And this song here is a scene in the book where he's about to walk in and meet the crew, the uptown swells, as Coleman likes to call them, that he'll be presiding over. And he's a little bit nervous about it, and his father-in-law, George, is whispering into his ear the dirty secrets of the wealthy, telling him that the way to control or to be at ease among the wealthy is to know their dirty secrets. So he's trying to relax Billy, and he says to him, calm yourself, Billy, there's nothing to fear. Here come your royal subjects, your peers. This is your moment. You've waited for years. You're the king of Mardi Gras. Who'd have thought you'd reach such dizzying heights? There's no place to go but down from tonight. I don't want to brag, but it just seems right that I'm the king of Mardi Gras. I'm the squeaky, shiny, freshly minted king of Mardi Gras this year. Police will bow, the crowds kowtow when my royal float draws near. I get to toast the mayor, be drunk by noon. I get my regal face on every single Rex doubloon. Look at poor Leon, such a sordid affair, soliciting boys in Jackson Square. Everyone knows, just make sure they don't stare. You're their king of Mardi Gras. Here comes old Cedric, he's had a fabulous year. A hush fills the room as his young wife draws near. He pimps her out gladly to advance his career. And you're their king of Mardi Gras. Miss Helen's been sickly since the Huey Long days. She swears it's consumption, but it's alcohol haze. They're dressy but messy in so many ways. And you're their king of Mardi Gras. He's our squeaky, shiny, freshly minted king of Mardi Gras this year. At the Boston Club, you're free to snub your best friends and we'll cheer. You get to condescend, if you so choose, to the riffraff and the commoners on St. Charles Avenue. We're not crassly democratic like those ghastly super crews. They'll take any Ed or Harry who can pay the paltry dues. You're familiar with our motto, pro bono publico, which means to serve the public, at least the ones we know. We're the bluest of blue bloods, the foiest of gras, bejeweled, encrusted, entitled, and flawed, backslapping, boozy, soignier, and raw. And you're our king of Mardi Gras. It's this cluster of cronies tonight at the ball who can cover our assets with one simple call. So what if the banks will evict us come fall? Right now, you're the king of Mardi Gras. You're our king of Mardi Gras. I'm the king of Mardi Gras. How many people here from Chicago, by the way? You got any Chicago people in the house? Hold up your hand, Chicago in the house. All right, Steve Goodman fans, guy that wrote City, New Orleans?
Yeah.
All right, so this is a song that it takes an encyclopedic knowledge of the English language just to even attempt to tackle. It's so long. But I got Chicago fans that escape every year, both the chilly winter winds and the already subpar Chicago subs, Cubs. And so this is for my Chicago friends like me. By the shores of old Lake Michigan, where the hawk wind blows so cold, an old Cub fan lay dying in his midnight hour that tolled. Round his bed, his friends had all gathered. They knew his time was short, and on his head they placed the bright blue cap from his all-time favorite sport. He said, "It's late and it's getting dark in here, and I know it's time to go. But before I leave the lineup, there's just one thing I'd like to know. Do they still play the blues in Chicago when baseball season rolls around? When the snow melts away, do the Cubbies still play in their ivory-covered burial ground? When I was a boy, they were my pride and joy, but now they only bring fatigue to the land of the brave, the home of the free. They're the doormat of the National League. You know, the law of averages says anything will happen that can. But the year the Cubs last won a National League pennant was the year we dropped the bomb on Japan. The Cubs made me a criminal. Yeah, that's right. They stole my youth from me. I'd forsake my teachers to go sit in the bleachers in flagrant truancy. One thing led to another. Soon I discovered gambling, alcohol, and dope. Football, hockey, lacrosse, but what do you expect when you raise up a young boy's hopes and then just crush him like so many paper beer cups? Year after year after year, after year after year after year after year after year, until those hopes are just so much popcorn for the pigeons to eat beneath the L tracks. He said, "You know, I'll never see Wrigley Field anymore before my eternal rest. But if you get your scorecard and you give me a pencil, I'll give you my last request." He said, "Give me a doubleheader, a funeral at Wrigley Field on some sunny weekend day, no lights. Have the organ play the national anthem, and then a little na-na-na, hey-hey-hey, goodbye. Make six bullpen pitchers carry my coffin. Have six groundkeepers clear my path. Have the umpires bark me out at every base in all their holy wrath. It's a beautiful day for a funeral. Hey, Ernie, let's play two. Somebody go get Harry Carey to come back and conduct just one more interview. Have the Cubbies run right out into the middle of the field. Have Keith Moreland drop a routine fly. Give everybody two bags of peanuts and a frosting malt, and I'll be ready to die. Build a big fire out of your Louisville Slugger baseball bats on home plate and toss my coffin in. Let the ashes blow in the beautiful snow from the prevailing 30-mile-an-hour southwest wind. When my last remains go flying over the left field wall, we'll bid the bleacher bums adieu. And I will come to my final resting place out on Waveland Avenue. The dying man's friends told him to stop it. They said, cut it out, that's an awful shame. He said, don't cry, we'll meet by and by near the Heavenly Hall of Fame. He said, I've got season tickets to watch the Angels now, and that's just what I'm gonna do. But it's you, the living, that are stuck here with the Cubs, so it's me that feels sorry for you. He said, I'll play me that lonesome loser's tune. You know, the one I like the best. And then he closed his eyes and he slipped away. And what we got here is a dying Cubs fan's last request. Do they still play the blues in Chicago when baseball season rolls around? When the snow melts away, do the Cubbies still play in their ivy-covered burial ground? When I was a boy, they were my pride and joy, but now they only bring fatigue to the land of the brave, the home of the free, and the doormat of the National League.